Hello, everyone, and welcome to LARP Chat Live, hosted by the Geek Initiative. I am Tara. I'm the senior editor of the Geek Initiative, and tonight I am joined by Lizzie Stark. She is an author, a journalist, and a game designer, and I have had the pleasure of playing in a few of her games and games that she's run. And we have tons of questions for Lizzie all about freeform LARP and game design and LARP in general. So, Lizzie, welcome.
Thanks so much for having me. I'm just delighted to be here.
Excellent. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to actually queue up questions for you. And if anybody else has any questions, you can actually type /Q into the chat area. And then those questions will come up on the side for Lizzie to answer. So we're going to go ahead and forgive me because usually I have Max, my co-host, but he is unfortunately sick this week. He got the con plague after everybody else. So,
Are you recovered? You had the con plague last week too.
I did. I didn't get it too badly. I gave it to my husband. He got it pretty badly. He had like delayed con plague too. So that's what happened. But yeah, for those of us who don't know what we're talking about, Lizzie and I were both at Dreamation, and it's a big gaming convention, and we had an awesome time there. And did a lot of LARPing. So we're going to dig right in and start talking about the different types of LARPing that there are. And I specifically want to ask you about freeform LARP because that's something you know a lot about and I have very little experience about. And so if you could tell us, what is freeform LARP and how is it different from the American campaign buffer LARP that most of our viewers are more familiar with?
Yes. So freeform means a lot of different things to different communities. Like if you go to England, it means one thing. And if you go to New Zealand, it means another thing. And if you go to Denmark, it means something else. So I'm most familiar with kind of the Danish meaning of the phrase. The Danes call freeform tabletop often, which is very confusing to me. But I think the best way to sort of think about it is as a continuum. So on one side of the continuum, you've got like hardcore trad role-playing games, mm-hmm. right? Where you don't do what your character does, you say what your character does, and you roll some dice, and you say what your character is doing. And on the other end of the spectrum, you've got LARP. And in sort of the most prototypical LARP, like LARP to the max, you press play at the beginning of the LARP, and then the experience goes until it's over, and then you call a hold, and then that was your LARP, right? And there's a lot of kind of sandboxiness in there. You know, you're killing monsters, or maybe this week you're just hanging out at the tavern, whatever. So, right. So freeform is, so think of it as a continuum. At one end of the continuum, you've got tabletop gaming. At the other end of the continuum, you've got like hardcore LARP. All of the stuff in the middle is freeform. And it's the stuff that borrows like some tabletop techniques and some LARP techniques. So mostly what we talk about when we're talking about freeform is we talk about like scenes. A lot of freeform games have scenes and scenes start and end. It's just like when you're playing a tabletop game and you skip over like the 15 minute walk to the dungeon, right? You don't play that out. It's your GM's just like, okay, and now you're at the dungeon, go. Same thing in a freeform game. So you can skip around in time. And that's one hallmark of it. Also, when you start kind of pulling apart the role play experience like that, there's a lot of cool and random stuff you can do. For example, you might not be the only person playing your character. So that's called, when you are the only person playing your character, that's called character monogamy. Because you're monogamous with your character. but in a freeform game, it might be like, okay, I might say, okay, Tara, we are going to play an argumentative businesswoman together. And I'm going to be her smarts. And you're going to be her business savvy. And we'll like tap in and out of the scene.
Oh, that's pretty cool. All right. Like different aspects of the same character, basically.
Exactly. Or you can use meta techniques, which are ways of sort of, you break the flow of the narrative to heighten the drama. So one of the most common meta techniques is called monologuing. And that's when we're having a great scene and then the meta technique happens. Maybe the game master calls for it, or maybe I initiate it because I'm wondering what your character is thinking. And you open a window into your character's mind, right? And in character, I don't hear it, but as a player, I do hear it. And this is great because I know a lot of people think metagaming is a dirty word, but there's a lot of amazing stuff you can do with metagaming to sort of heighten the emotional experience. So if I know that your character is, you know, afraid of failing or afraid of like a past time that you failed in something or other, I can then ask you about that a lot in character, and that provides interesting play. So these are all tools in the freeform toolbox. Usually you don't get all of them in one game, but you get some. And I also, I should add that I have a post about freeform.
Feel free to drop any links into the chat box there.
Yeah. It's called Freeform for Noobs. And so this form of freeform comes out of the Danish convention Festival. And Festival has this really interesting tradition, scenario writing tradition. So every time you show up to Festival, you can play maybe 30 different games. And the games were all written that year, and they were selected to get into the festival. So, you know, maybe 70 people send synopses and only 30 of them get in. And then there's this award, this grand award ceremony tradition that they have. That tradition has gone to lots of other places in the world because they write down the instructions for how to run their games. And so that's part of how it's kind of traveled to the US. And now there are a lot of designers in the US who are kind of taking the football from the Danes and remixing it and changing it to fit our tradition.
I feel like I'm always kind of searching for this medium between, you know, just combat LARPing with boffers and things that are maybe like more abstract, at least to an American boffer campaign LARPer. And I feel like the more, you know, I try different stuff, the closer I get. I felt like the Game of Thrones LARP that I played was pretty close because they used the chrono system, but it was a lot of the techniques for interacting were similar to the boffer campaign LARPs that I'm used to. So I feel like when I think about creating a LARP, especially just like a one-shot game, I feel like I'm really trying to like aim for that perfect medium. Are there any specific styles of play or LARPs that you can suggest if I'm looking for something that's really kind of in the center there?
I mean, I think one thing worth saying is that no one game can deliver every awesome experience. Do you know what I mean? Like, one of the awesome things about buffer campaigns is the rush of battle.
Yeah.
You know? And you, like, if you're not playing in a buffer campaign game, you probably just won't get that.
Yeah.
And that's okay. But so I think it's important to think of LARP as being a really diverse medium. There are all of these different formats for telling stories. Right. So what was your question? Your question was like, where do you look?
If I wanted something like in between, like solidly in the middle, what would I go for?
Solidly in the middle. Well, there are lots of different options. But one would be, there are LARPs in the style of LARPs from the Factory.
Okay.
LARPs from the Factory is an anthology of 24 short LARPs. Like, they're kind of like in residency. They last maybe like say 2 to 8 hours. It mm-hmm. varies on the game. And these were written in Norway. Norway has this kind of cool tradition of LARP factories, which is the idea behind them is that it should be really easy to sign up for a LARP. It should be as easy as signing up to go for a movie. Right? Maybe you're anticipating it eagerly, the release date, for a month, or maybe you decide that day to just show up.
Mm-hmm.
So they're quite easy to run. And there were a few factories. There's one in Trondheim and one in Oslo that were running for a few years. And their deal was they put on a LARP every month. And most of those LARPs were written fresh for this experience. I was part of a project with my co-editors, Ilan Nilsson and Trine Liss Lindahl from Norway, to basically help the creators of those LARPs write instructions for running them. And if you Google LARPs from the factory, you can find it pretty easily, or I'm sure I have a link around somewhere. Those games are cool because they take a lot of the Nordic techniques and they apply them to a wide range of genres. So, you know, so the typical kind of Nordic layout is to have a workshop before the game, and then you play the game, and then afterward you talk about the game as part of the debrief. And so most of the games have those three parts. Some of them, there's one called The Hirelings, which is a like a freeform version of Dungeons and Dragons almost.
Oh, cool.
you play a bunch of people going for, you play like noobs going on your first Dungeons and Dragons adventure. Nice. You've got this harsh paladin who's gonna, you know, who's training you up to go in there. And then when you get to the dungeon, we don't play the dungeon because everybody's played that 1,000 times. And you cut to the scene afterward when where you come out and there's all of this random treasure that includes the paladin's head. And then you go to post-dungeon therapy with your group to process.
That's awesome.
that sounds fun. There are a couple LARPs about time travel in there that are pretty interesting. And then you also have LARPs that are, I would say, super duper arty. One of my favorite games from the book is called Before and After Silence, which is a game about the power of silence in a world of sound. And there
that sounds
is no...
very Shia LaBeouf.
yeah. It's a great game, but yeah. So that would be a really good place to look. Another place you could look would be at the Danish scenario writing tradition. I have up on my thing, they have a place called alexandria.dk that has like a really good record of, it has all of the LARP scripts from like the last 30 years of Fastival, basically. Not all of them are in English, only a few of them are in English, but we're trying to put the thumbs screws to the Danes to get more of them translated. So that's another place. You could also look at the, well, anyway, I have a few more ideas for you. I have a post on awesome. American Freeform, which is kind of some, it's a wing of the Freeform tradition that made it over into the States. And there are a lot of pretty interesting games there. Jason Morningstar has been just turning them out like hotcakes.
Awesome.
He's the designer of Fiasco.
I'm hoping to get up to, you know, writing one, because I write lots of short stories and I LARP like all the time, like one or two games, like, you know, long running campaign games per month. So I'm really hoping I can get into writing them. And one thing that I really enjoy about freeform LARPs is like, you can show up and not necessarily be like super prepared. Whereas yeah. like, you can't really just roll into like an American Buffer campaign LARP and not know anything about the game world, or, you know, not have like super elaborate costuming. So once I learned that, yeah, and once I learned that, I was like, oh, I could just like roll into any of these, you know, whenever I want. This is great. So yeah. I'm a fan of that, because I can see doing that instead of like having, you know, a super long party. I could see hosting like a 4-hour game, you know, and that could be really fun.
Yeah, a lot of these games are designed to have a small social footprint, so they don't take that many people. The space they take isn't that elaborate, and the time they take isn't that long. Also, one thing that is quite different from most Boffer campaigns in the US is the number of rules. There's not the volume of rules that your typical Boffer campaign.
Which is so scary. It's scary to me. I mean, I'm getting used to it, but it's actually more intimidating than a 300-page rule book.
Oh, yes. Well, you know, for me, I find the rules more intimidating. I can't keep them in my head all at the same time. And, you know, some people get so much pleasure out of optimizing the rules to make it, you know, make things the maximum best for their character. And I am not a fan of that.
And, you know,
and I'm not very good at it either.
One thing I find in my home game is, there's a skill called diplomacy that you can take, and you can call the skill, and it you know, makes the other person deal with you. And I haven't taken the skill, even though it's a very common bard skill, because I'm like, I refuse to take it. I should be a good enough role player that I can just role play being diplomatic enough or charming enough for you to want to deal with me. You know what I mean? And so I still haven't taken diplomacy. And, you know, although I love the rules of that game, I see how, you know, some things are there so that maybe you want to play that kind of character and you aren't that good at role playing diplomacy. But if you are, then hey, there's a skill, you know, that yeah. you can take. And one thing I like about Freeform is I can like more heavily explore one area of myself, and it's just, you know, straight up role playing. And I'm always, I think, because I'm used to the campaign LARPs, I'm consistently the most violent character in every Freeform game, because it's like the real world. Like, if you show a little aggression in most of these games, people are going to be like, whoa, whoa, whoa. And I'm like, yeah, that's right, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Well, I think like the Freeform way to deal with the diplomacy thing would be like, you only put diplomacy in your game if diplomacy is super duper 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 important to the game, to the game's functioning. And then instead of, and then what you do is you would do some workshopping to make sure people feel comfortable with it. So we'd, you know, so we'd get, you get people used to trying to wheel and deal with each other. Or you try to create an atmosphere that's really kind and supportive, so that like, Tara, maybe you tell us that you aren't good at diplomacy, but the whole group knows that you think you aren't good at diplomacy, and we want to help you be good at diplomacy because you're our co-player and we want you to have a good time and be in good scenes. And because we know that out of game, we can kind of help you. We can help you with role play. Or of course, the last resort is if you're no good at diplomacy, and I'm always playing leader characters and having spectacular failure. And some of the time, what I say is I say I'm playing to lose, because sometimes failure is more fun than success. But really, it just secretly happens. I'm not a very good leader in a LARP sense. And so I'm always tanking whoever.
I get so far with it. And then I realize, like, no matter what I do, some people are going to hate me. Some people might like me, but some people are going to hate me. And, you know, my main character is in that situation now where there's like, probably two people that are just really not into her. They're just really against all of her objectives. And everybody else is like indifferent or on board. And I'm like, man, these two people are just like ruining her life. What can I do?
That's a great scene opportunity. Talk to them out of game and be like, let's have a fight in the town square and I'll lose.
I think it might happen. I don't know. We'll see. Yeah. Like sometimes
play, you know, to the pain.
Right? Sometimes I want to like plan that stuff in the campaign LARPs, and other times I'm like, I don't know, I don't want to like give too much away, because it's like, you know, it is more of a play to win scenario. Especially in this instance, my character, like, she's very loyal. She's gonna win everything for her kingdom and her king. So yeah. Yeah, but there are some scenes that, you know, other players and I have kind of planned ahead a little bit, or like songs we rehearsed. So the characters might break into song because they can do that. But obviously that requires a little bit of rehearsal beforehand. Also, hi, Sam. Not hearing you, Sam.
Oh.
No.
I was on mute. So.
Oh, there you go. Now you're here. So last time on LARP Chat Live, I was enthusing about my experience playing your game in residency, and you said that I definitely went full Nordic. Can you explain what that means?
Yes. So it has to do with a stereotype about Nordic LARP. So right. So Nordic LARP is a thing. It's kind of like it's like a Boffer campaign plus Freeform, sort of. In that there aren't very many rules, and it can be about, often the topics can be quite dour. What Nordic LARP is like a whole super long conversation, but the stereotype about the Nords is that they're always playing games that sound super unfun, right? So like you're playing people in a bomb shelter after a nuclear bomb goes off, slowly realizing that they're gonna die. Or you play like a very popular LARP called Just a Little Leaven, which is a LARP about the summer AIDS came to New York City, and you play like the 4th of July, 1980, 1981, and 1982, and you play members of the gay community and I believe polyamorous cancer survivors, polyamorous people who survived cancer as children, I think.
Wow.
And it's a game about friendship and death. And it's been run several times, and it's being rerun in, it's been run in Denmark, Sweden, and Norway. It's been in France, or it's coming to France this summer, and it's going to be in the US in 2017, I believe. So, you know, a lot of games are really kind of set up for, to investigate topics that are serious and sad.
Okay, so now I see what you mean, because my character in your game realized probably a little more than halfway through the game that she had a perfect theme with my character. She had an unrequited love. And then the other theme that you might have noticed, my writing is very Irish-American, and my I think my play style is too. And her romance sort of went along with that, as did the actual work that she was creating within your game. So I guess that does kind of on a deeper level or on a cultural level appeal to me a bit.
And I should add also, in Bofur LARP, you're quite often playing to win. Mm-hmm. And in Nordic LARP, sort of one of the main play aesthetics and what a lot of people aim toward is playing to lose.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the super Nordic experience is one where like you cry at the end of it. You know, and all the Nordic GMs trade jokes about collecting tears from players.
Player tears like in a jar, right?
Yeah, it's like, I made them emote, yes.
Nice. So let's say you're interested in playing freeform LARPs. What is the best way to jump in and start? And I'm going to do a little BRB as you answer and kind of hand things over to Sam for just a minute.
Oh, God, help me.
Well, my dog is eating a notebook, so I had to attend to that. No. So be right back.
Just, you know, use the black speech from here. I mean, if you can see the dog eating the notebook.
Yeah. Oh, I see somebody who says she or they cry in Bofur LARPs as well. Good role playing is good role playing. That's totally true. Nordic LARP in no way has a monopoly on making people feel feelings. They're just designing for it to happen very soon in the role play experience, and they're designing for it aggressively.
It's engineered rather than emergent by accident.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So the best way for people to start playing some freeform games, I mean, you can try your local conventions, but really, you should run one.
Oh.
That's the best way.
I want to run one, but I'm terrified of running one.
your first time is always scary, but you just do it and you get through it. Some good ones to run would be, okay, so I have a guide to GMing Nordic Freeform that I'll post in the comments. But you can also look at alexandria.dk. If you want something pretty heavy on the Nordic, you could go to jeepin.org, which is a, jeepin is like a special subset.
Oh yeah, jeepform, right?
Jeepform, yeah. I highly recommend that everyone check out the Golden Cobra contest. They have free downloads of 2-hour games on a variety of topics, and there must be 100 free games for download. There's an anthology from last year and an anthology for this year.
Awesome.
Yeah. So basically, your job is to pick the right scenario to get your group hooked on freeform and then make them run freeform games for you. Worked for me.
Excellent. And
there are actually a couple of narrative role-playing games that sort of dovetail nicely with that. Penny for My Thoughts and Fiasco would be the two main ones.
Oh, I played Fiasco. Yeah. That's pretty cool. Yeah. We actually did that in my theater.
There are basic mechanics, but it's if you can get a group involved in that, then eventually the mechanics just sort of fall away.
Yeah, I feel like the actors in my theater group who weren't gamers didn't quite understand it, but like those of us who were LARPers were like, yes, I got this, I get where it's going, you know. We were kind of guided through it, and everyone else you know, did, I guess maybe didn't have as much guidance, or maybe needed some more guidance. But yeah, Fiasco, I thought Fiasco was a great game.
Yes. And and Jason Morningstar, the designer of Fiasco, is designing like many, many short LARPs.
Yeah.
Like, many, many, many short LARPs. And of course, Alexandria.dk, which has many in English. And I also have a, let's see, I have a post with links, so I will find that.
Awesome. I didn't realize that was Jason's game, and I totally like LARPed with him at Trumation, but okay.
Yeah. Yeah, he's the head of Bully Pulpit. He's got one I've wanted to play for a while called the Shas Al-Hiri Roach. That's another one where it's mostly freeform, but there are like a couple of minor role-playing mechanics to sort of facilitate.
Awesome. So, Lizzie, I want to be very conscious of your time, and I'm going to pack two more questions in. Yes,
okay.
You're on deadline. I get how that is. I want to ask two questions. One of them is going to be very selfish, and then my second question is going to be to ask you to promote whatever you're working on, whatever you've got for sale, where people can buy your books, etc. But my first question is, I'd like to write a LARP. Where do I start, and what's the best process? And I'm talking specifically about freeform LARP.
I suggest that you play in a bunch of stuff because some techniques work better than others. Some things look terrible on paper, but then they're amazing in play. So I would say play, play, play. See if there's been other stuff written on the same topic that you are interested in writing about and play those games. So, you know, so play, play, play. And then I think another thing about freeform games is that they're typically not too long. And so you just don't have enough time to do more than like one or two things. So I think a lot of the game design is in thinking about which one or two aspects of the experience you really want to hit on, and then you just cut everything else.
Okay, so focus on like experience and maybe theme, basically.
Yeah, exactly. And then playtest, like playstorm and playtest is really important because sometimes things look great on paper, but they just don't
work out. Yes.
And oftentimes you can make a really subtle shift that solves your problem. That would be the other advice I would give. So
awesome.
You know, telling the players X, Y, Z might solve all of the play problems that there are. It's happened to me.
Awesome. One thing that you do that I really like in your games is you have different kind of like archetypes or different roles, and then the player really kind of fills in the details, but it gives them like enough info to get started. And it's like when you reach out for that type of like that role that you want, it's kind of like, which part of myself do I want to kind of like explore today and learn from today? And, you know, that is one thing that really kind of helped me connect as a player.
Yeah. Well, how to write character sheets is like a totally different thing. I definitely stole that from some indie tabletop games.
I have a book all about character archetypes. And as soon as I played the first game that you ran, I was like, oh man, it reminds me of that book, because sometimes if I need help with like writing characters, I'll just dive into this book and be like, what don't I understand and want to learn more about? I'll just start here. So that's definitely probably something that's going to help me. And yeah. I'm very conscious of your time. I know what it's like to be on deadline.
Don't worry too much about it. One more thing I want to say about writing characters is that the characters have to fit the game. So like in Residency, which is a game about an artist's colony where you're kind of thinking about the art that you're making, I think it's really important to have the players co-create something because that's kind of what art is. And it would be hard to do that with a character you just hand them.
So now I get a little bit more what you mean, like when people say, is LARP just a game or is it art? I don't think I really like connected with it before, but having played in Residency, I kind of get it because you are making something new together.
Yeah, and it's kind of always like that, but as the facilitator, you're sort of controlling the variation that the stories are going to have to be within sort of a certain range. And in some games, you want that range to be much more narrow. I have another game called The Curse, which is about decision-making around hereditary breast cancer. And the characters in that game are much more prescriptive because I need the players to know a certain amount of stuff about the experience, otherwise the game won't work. And if I let them be loosey-goosey and go everywhere, then the play won't follow my vision, or the play won't be, might not be as interesting for them as well. So yeah, so that's what I mean. So like, you know, you want to sort of develop your technique toolbox so that when you go to pick the tools that are best for your game idea, you can, you know what to pick.
Awesome. And the last thing I want to ask, what are you working on now? And what would you like everyone to know about? What do you want to promote?
Well, actually, I took a trip to the docks of Boston yesterday and the airport twice to pick up this lovely book.
Yay!
Hashtag feminism. This is a co-collaborative project that I edited along with the U.S. designer Misha Buschjäger and Swedish designer Anna Westerling. It's 34 teeny tiny, less than 1 hour nano games about feminism written by participants from 11 different countries. A lot of people worked very hard on that book. I'm very proud that it's finally arrived. I think you're gonna be able to get at least the PDF of that on DriveThruRPG pretty soon. And also hard copies will be kicking around in conventions. And it has already been a teaching tool in schools. It's been played awesome. At universities in Boston, Kentucky, California, Texas, and plans to go to a few more. So that's that one of my awesome. Current projects. I have two other current projects. One is I'm helping Emily Kerr Boss, who's an amazing freeform designer, an amazing US freeform designer, who actually coined the term lead. It's one of her claims to fame. I'm helping edit her collection, the romance trilogy of three games about romance, and they're designed to take people who are comfortable with tabletop to being comfortable with freeform. So that actually would be kind of a good resource for you and your groups, maybe. I'm working on that, and then I'm also the co-program lead for the Living Games Conference in Austin, which is going to be a ton of fun. This is a convention that where people are going to go to play some games and also to talk about LARP. And we're hoping it will be a meeting point for people from many, many different traditions. So, you know, like some of our presenters are from AmptGuard. Some of our presenters are from Utopia Rising. We also have people coming from Sweden and Norway and Denmark to present about all of the cool stuff they're doing. We're going to have Ben and Maury, who are the New World Magic Scola organizers, are keynoting. And you'll have an opportunity to sample all of these games. And hopefully we can kind of come together to help the hobby grow.
Awesome.
And to learn from each other too. So I'm really excited about that. That is in April. It's in May in Boston.
Well, thank you so much for being so open to discussing freeform with us campaign LARPers. I know we often get put down like kind of just at the bottom rung in the LARP scheme of things, but I have had such great experience you know, doing both kinds, and I look forward to doing more. And you know, whenever I see your name on the list of people running games, I like race to sign up, and I encourage everyone else to do the same. And thank you so, so much. Good luck with your deadline.
Thanks for having me. And I just want to add, I love Buffer LARP too. That's how I got my start in that hobby.
Come down to Seventh Kingdom someday.
All right.
All right.
Have a good one.
Have a good
day. Thanks so much for having me.
Sure. Bye.
Good night.
Bye.
So. Freeform LARP. I would say my only thing is, the only thing I feel lacking afterwards is I feel like, maybe this is something about me personally, but it could also be something about how I'm used to LARPing. I feel like I always like need to express a little bit of violence, you know?
And yeah,
if there isn't a system for it, like, it's the same, it's not just freeform, it's the same feeling I get with tabletop games. Even if you're doing like a dungeon crawl and you're just like, hey, Amy, and you're just like killing shit left and right, I come out of like, I really wish I could have been in the middle of battle and just hit some stuff with a bopper, you know? Like, I don't know, maybe I'm uncultured swine because of that, but...
No, that makes sense. I actually have the same reaction for... Well, not the same reaction. I have the reverse reaction for the same reason. Sort of got turned around. I've had to drop my coffee intake due to certain issues, and it's really playing havoc with my head and word loss and shit. But in any case, when I get through a LARP and I haven't been in combat at all, it's like, it's great for me that I have finally been able to get through something without like having to be aggressive or firing off a single shot.
See, I feel like in real life, society is all either it doesn't take me seriously if I'm trying to be aggressive. And even in some LARP settings, you know, I'm not taken seriously when I'm being very, very aggressive. And being able to LARP that is sort of like the only place I can do that, you know, where it's like acceptable within the rules of the environment and also where it's actually like taken seriously. And I gotta say, like, that's one thing my character is like having big problems with at my main game is like, she's done a lot to prove that she's serious business and some people aren't taking her seriously. And I'm just saying there might be consequences.
It's too smart to mean.
She's warning people ahead of time. Yeah.
Yeah, next month at Seventh Kingdom IGE.
I think one of the
Target spot.
I think one of the really interesting things that jumped out to me about the freeform is some of the scenarios she was saying about like being like a cancer, you know, a cancer survivor and a cancer patient survivor. And I can definitely see why you would need to sort of have that bleed decompression situation after that. I mean, to carry around with that. Yeah. I mean, imagine that something like that is really near and dear to a lot of people's hearts. I mean, we can all imagine being heroic adventurers, but most of us probably haven't experienced it the same way. But if you've lost someone to cancer, you have, you know, gone through that yourself. I mean, a much different connection to your source material. And that seemed a little scary to me.
when you're LARPing in a campaign game every month, it'll eventually touch on a theme or...
Right.
Your character will be close to somebody who dies. I mean, at 7K, the characters get 7 lives. So usually the characters get to know each other for a while before one of them kicks the bucket, you know, or gets taken away. And that can be a really emotional thing that even if it's a completely in character that you need to play through. And I'd love to see more of the debriefing, especially that is done in the freeform playstyle. I think it's really helpful, and I think it's okay to acknowledge that we have bleed, but it's like, it's such a dirty word in our community, or it was, it's getting a little better, but I think it's okay to acknowledge it. I'd rather people just say so than be like, oh, well, I completely separate everything, you know, in and out of game. It's like, do you?
I think it depends though. Like, I mean, my impression or understanding, especially as a LARP, you know, as a buffer LARP, is that like a lot of my characters are aspects of myself. So I absolutely acknowledge that bleed exists automatically because I'm playing this aspect of myself or that aspect of myself. Like I can't separate those pieces out. What's interesting about some of her situations or some of the freeform situations is it would be something that I'm not creating, that I'm being handed. So I'm being forced to play something that maybe isn't an aspect of myself. And so I can see how that would be almost like a lot more important maybe to sort of separate the bleed out, that I'm not carrying around these heavy emotions about, you know, being an incest survivor, for example. Thank God I don't have that experience. So I can definitely see that. But yeah, it's interesting in a buffer LARP as well, because I've definitely had moments where I have cried real tears, and not just role playing, where I've cried real tears because I've lost characters or have been in situations where, you know, we've made people cry, or I've cried, you know, from situations I've experienced. So yeah, I don't know where I'm going with that. Somebody else jump in.
It's normal to have those moments, I think. I mean, I've definitely had them, or moments where I was like upset about something out of game and was like, this is great, I can go escape my problems and LARP. but then like you get upset about the in-game. Right. You get upset right. in-game, and then like 20 minutes later I'm crying over someone's corpse, you know? And it's like, am I really crying over someone's corpse and character? Yes. But, you know, it's also really cathartic right. because I'm able to express that, you know? So there's value to it.
I'm also in the SEA, and I remember a few years ago that we had a situation where when one set of royalty was being, you know, was stepping down, another set was stepping up, and they chose to do it as a death, that, you know, the king had died and the queen was going to go into a comic. She was mourning him. And I remember that individual, she's also a friend of mine, having a really difficult time because even though it was a scenario, it was her real life husband, and she was role playing the death of her real partner and her real life husband. And you know, afterwards, her kind of having that moment of, I didn't think it was going to be as dramatic or touch me as badly as it was, because it was all planned out and we were all, right. you know, rehearsing it and stuff. But it ended up being really very challenging for her emotionally to go through something like that. So I think that's probably something that happens too. You know, we all walk in like, I can handle it. And then it hits you at the wrong moment.
Yeah. Yeah, I think also, you know, like, it's like, in like you were saying, in the moment, you don't even realize like where it's going, and then it just kind of hits you. It's tough. And then like, you know, with my experience in the freeform games, I'm surprised how like in character and immersed I can get within like a couple of hours. It's really weird. That kind of really surprised me, you know, because in a buffer campaign fantasy LARP, I can go in with my crew and like it'll take me a couple hours to get into character if I'm playing a new character, but then I'm like, I'm in, I'm good, but it takes me a while. And some of these games I'm in character in like 20 minutes because of the exercises they run you through. And that's something I'm really looking forward to about New World Magiscola, because you know we're gonna get that time to form relationships with other characters and stuff like that, and discuss before it begins. And I didn't understand that at first, because you know in the kind of games that we're used to playing, it's like, okay, you go in and then you usually form those relationships, unless you're like going in with a group and you kind of like make it up beforehand. And to me it always seemed more genuine to sort of go in and then form those relationships as you go, or because of your political affiliation or in game or whatever. And I was nervous about that with New World Magiscola, because it's like, it felt like it might be meta in a bad way. But now that I've played some more freeform games, I'm like, oh no, that's great, because the relationship you make that you want to keep, you just strengthen. And then the other ones, they don't work. You don't have to force them. So I'm looking forward to it.
I think I'd like to try it, but I'd probably transition better with a fantastic setting. You know what I mean? I don't know if I could walk into some of the heavy duty emotional ones, but yeah, I could pretend to be, like I was joking. My husband really wants to run an Explorers Club evening. We've been watching a lot of Penny Dreadful. So he really wants to run like a pseudo Victorian Explorers Club evening. And I thought, man, that might be a really nice transition to something like a freeform LARP, where everybody creates their character and comes into the situation and we just see what happens. And, you know, but still more fantastic and less, you know, less realistic to start off with, I guess.
Oh, gosh.
I didn't want to interrupt, but have either of you heard of a game called Baron Munchausen?
I have not, no.
Okay, I'm going to put the link in the chat, but it is perfect for an evening like that. The idea is a bottle of wine, and I think it's a bunch of poker chips or whatever you want to sort of facilitate as money or something like that. And then it's someone tells a story, and as you're going around telling the story, then someone else can just sort of wager one of their chips or wager some of their money and go, oh no, that's an utter lie, because at the same time, as you said, you were about to be executed by the Sultan, I saw you drinking it up with the harem guards. How could you possibly have been during that? And then if you can take the chip and you can continue your story and alter it with the details and things like that, and it gets more and more ridiculous, or you know, and at a certain point you can keep refusing to add certain things to your story, but you know, because you're shifting around these chips, if you run out of chips you're going to eventually have to take somebody's additions to your story.
Yeah,
and it just turns into a thing. And then on top of that, the wine's mandatory, so everybody's getting drunk in the process.
I like that part. I played a story game at Metatopia before, and now I can't for the life of me remember what it was called. I'll look it up. But one thing I loved about this, so in real life, I write horrible villains. I cannot write a villain. We all know I love Thor. I'm not so into Loki. Okay, I don't get him. I just don't get it. I love, you know, I like the Paladin. You know, I'm also a Captain America fan. I like the Boy Scout. You know, that's just, I feel those characters, and I'm pretty good at writing them. Not good at the villain. But those story games can force me to learn how to write a character that maybe doesn't have the best intentions, you know, because like at worst I can write a really good freedom fighter slash maybe terrorist. That's like the worst I can do. Other than that, like I just can't do it. I have a rough time with writing villains. So there, you know, there are some applications for stories like that. And we were talking about Fiasco before. That's another one that kind of like forced my character into doing something that was a little nefarious, I suppose. And it's just, I never would do that on my own.
Nobody's ambiguously the good guy in a game of Fiasco by the end, unless you're doing it wrong.
That's true.
Like, absolutely everybody had wrong, and that's part of the fun of it.
And yes, Amy's saying Team Cap, and I'm totally...
I'm partial. I married him, so you know.
Yeah, go ahead. oh, good. The seat is open. I thought that I'd need like hypertext or something to open the seat, but now the seat's open.
Yeah, Matt, call in. I want to hear this story.
Hey, go ahead. Do it.
Pressure, Matt. It's pressure. There we go.
There we go.
I'm assuming it's in the context of role playing. He didn't just start hitting people with bricks. So, I'd like to hear that.
Well, you know, and it's why I have like a couple of bricks in my bag when I go around. I made you cry during the
I do it so I don't have to hug people and get con plague.
Con plague. Hey, Matt, how are you?
Hi, Matt.
Hello, everyone. Hey, Matt. Yeah, they're around for story time.
All right, let's hear it.
I was running a game called Deadlands Reloaded. And it was a pre-published adventure called Daddy's Boy. The way that it set out was the posse, which was a group of five players, wound up going to a woman's house out in the boonies. They were traveling from point A to point B. The woman had lost her husband in the Civil War, and she had a son. So she was like, you know, I'm really not comfortable with y'all staying here. The guy stay out in the barn, you know, he can stay here and the woman can come inside the house. And one of the posse members was a Texas Ranger. And I go, well, I guess you're going to stay and watch, right? And she goes, yeah. It's like, well, you start hearing digging sounds coming from this barn. And she goes, okay, well, I go check. I go, well, as you get closer, you hear a kid's voice going, I'm glad you're home, Paul. And she goes, okay. I was like, you think the dad has been dead by this point? And so she goes and looks in. And sees the boy talking to a giant steam-powered robot that was heavily damaged in battle. And she goes, well, I kind of don't know what to do. I was like, well, you're a Texas Ranger. You're supposed to handle supernatural stuff like this. So she goes in, makes sure she has her badge on, and she starts talking to it and finds out one of the horrible secrets of the setting. There are intelligent robots, but they use human brains, disembodied human brains. It gets better. This was the missing dad, who got damaged enough to remember who he was and come home.
That's not better. That's not better. I'm just saying.
It's better for me. And so everyone was like, you know, what can we do? I was like, well, there's not really anything you can do. Because you can't put his brain back in his body. He's a giant walking tank. And they're like, well, can we repair him? I go, well, yeah, if you do, but his war machine programming could come back on if you repair him. Well, is there a way to kill him? I was like, well, oh, and also if you try to repair him, looks like the self-destruct mechanism is still alive. So if you mess it up, you go, well, can we kill him? I was like, well, you'd have to pull his heat sort, the fuel out to let the boiler go cold. And slowly, that'd be a slow process. Fortunately, a bad guy showed up, and he went off to heroic sacrifice land. But no one was, left physically or emotionally undamaged. They were all crying. It was a very good story. Yeah, I was like, well, and they also went, well, can we send him to Texas Ranger? I goes, you can, but the Confederate government is dying to learn how to make these. Robots. So if you send him there, they're going to experiment on him and learn how to make their own. Enjoy the quandary of what you're supposed to do.
Oh, those type of decisions, man. Those type of decisions. That's my regular mark right there. How it always goes.
I was like, you can repair him and he goes back to being a war machine. You can send him to the government who will try to experiment on him and learn how to make machines like him. Or you can kill him. That's your only choices because he can't stay here.
You're a mean GM.
I know. Yeah, my choices are like, nope. Nope. I'm not playing this one. Okay. AI, so, not doing that to begin with. And then not, the dead husband's brain in the robot. Oh my God.
How are we going to get you to play an eclipse phase and deal with transhumans
in phase, sir?
How are we going to do that?
Roll 20, sir.
Don't you people read science fiction? AI, bad idea. Don't you watch
always movies?
Not always.
Always.
Vision was a good AI.
Commander Data.
There's an entire masturbatory subgenre of science fiction about how awesome the singularity is and how awesome it'll be when AIs gain Satan.
Oh my God, that's a nightmare. My middle school students already know. Say, like, no AI. I have indoctrinated them.
So we brought up another topic over in the chat, and I'm really upset that Max isn't here. Yes, Matt finally saw it. I knew he would freak out when he saw it, which is 7C, which I don't know a ton about, but I know it's pirates.
I do. I know about it.
There's an Ireland-type place in there, and that's what sold me.
There is, but here's the thing. Do you know those old movies they made in like the 30s, the 20s and 30s with swashbuckling and pirates and people like swinging from chandeliers during sword duels and all of that?
Yes.
Yeah, I think Earl
Flynn. The game lets you do that. The game incentivizes that.
Yes.
And so even like your wounds, when you take wounds, they're dramatic wounds, which both add to what your character can do and things like that. And give you weird little benefits. So there's this entire sort of line between, you get a cool scar. It's developed by a guy who made one of my favorite game systems of all time. So of course I'm going to splurge about it. Not Legend of the Five Rings. He made this terribly edited prestige project that he self-published called Houses of the Blooded. I've heard better as a LARP, but essentially the best way to describe it is every political part of Game of Thrones plus like a whole ton of Regency romance, and then they just sort of let you have at it. Like the stats that allow you combat are kind of dump stats for the most part, and there's one stat that's like ridiculously hard to enforced, but yeah, no. 7C is by the same guy. He's doing it for himself. Tara, are you all right? You just haven't moved in a while.
I'm all right. I'm here. I was typing.
She's moving.
Okay. She's mesmerized by story time.
It's he's basically doing it himself. He got the license back, and he's decided to expand it so now there's more settings that you can go to other than just basically this weird sort of fantasy Europe continent thing. He's adding like the New World and a bunch of other stuff, and it sounds really cool, and I'm about 20 bucks shy from getting the version that actually does stuff.
If you have 40 bucks, that gives you all the releases.
It gives you all the releases, but that also gives you anything they reach during the Kickstarter.
Right.
you get.
Yeah. And
we're doing free publicity for this guy. He'd be so ashamed of us.
He has money right now, like so much.
Yeah, the thing is, he's like, you know, I have never worked for free. I don't want anybody to work for free. If I'm doing something, then I'm getting something out of it.
He's got $828,000 and then some of his $30,000 goal.
7th&C is now the most funded RPG Kickstarter of all time.
So why do you guys think, so RPGs and also like card games and board games are doing really well on Kickstarter and Indiegogo, I've noticed lately.
Yeah.
LARPs, I've seen a lot try, and I have not seen many, if any, succeed in their crowdfunding efforts. Why do you think that is?
Tangible rewards. You get a book, you get a set of something, as opposed to investing in a character that maybe I'll play or not be able to play.
Also a matter of like time commitment. If you back a board game, they'll send you the board game.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You do not have to travel somewhere else with room and board and make sure that you have all your arrangements set up for the board game. They'll just send you a box.
Right. Or it's not something that you're already paying to play every month, and already have enough trouble like keeping up with that expense, and then you know you want to put more in on top of it. I guess that could be kind of a drag too. I'm always trying to think about this too, because so the Geek Initiative has used crowdfunding before, and you know, we had like some rewards, but it wasn't like, you know, a huge big like thing you get, or like a book or whatever. And now we have enough content. A couple people have suggested to me, why not compile all of the content on like a certain topic or something like that, and do like a best of book or something like that. And I find that the audience we resonate the most with, in terms of who gave us money when we crowdfunded, who participates the most in things like this, are the LARPers. So small community compared to geeks in general or women in geek culture in general, but the LARPers always, they always show up. You know, you guys are always here. It's always the LARPers. It's a really supportive community. And, you know, just like any family, we have our issues and our differences within. But, you know, I'm really trying to think about, you know, rewards and stuff that we could do in the future. Because I don't want to just, like, launch, like, any kind of crowdfunding campaign and not have, like, a book or something like that to do. So, I don't know. I've been thinking about that.
I think small rewards help too. You know, like when you crowdfund a lot, sorry, I'm cutting people off. But when you crowdfund, you get a lot of these little itty bitty rewards too. Like for a dollar, you can get a thank you. Well, if you get 500 people giving you a dollar, that's a decent amount of money. You know what I mean? And almost everybody, no matter what their economic background, who wants to contribute, can contribute a dollar if they want. But, you know, when you start your first tier at even 25, that starts to get a little. That can be a lot for somebody, you know what I mean? Especially if you're not sure if it's going to get funded or if the reward isn't worth your effort.
We're covering everything tonight. We went from like freeform LARP to tabletop to crowdfunding, but these are all really good things to talk about, because I don't know, at a loss with the crowdfunding, or maybe I'm just like burnt out because I like edit two blogs and I'm just like, whatever, I'll just throw my own money into it. And then, you know, much to my husband's horror.
And don't forget our story time, our fabulous story time with Sam and Matt.
Yes, fabulous story time. And then, oh, the other big news today, since now we're just talking about whatever nerd stuff. we all knew I was going to bring this up. So Wizard Girl Philly. Okay.
Oh, yeah.
My whole convention. They announced some guests today.
Oh,
Chris Hemsworth is among them. I'm so excited.
Yeah, they announced like a whole ton of MCU people are coming to Wizard World Philly.
Especially Thor. They announced him.
Yeah, my friend is a huge MCU fangirl, and so she was like all over that, going, "Oh my god, I gotta go now."
All right, Tara needs a minute, though. We gotta let her have
it. Tara, while we are having this minute with you, I have something that I have to say, and believe me, I wouldn't be saying this if I didn't have to. But because I took your money, 3,000 word maximum, and any interviews you desire.
Yes. For those who don't know, Sam is my conventions editor at the Geek Initiative. So
yeah, I am like the loosest, like freaking laziest editor ever in my own editor.
You are not.
But
I still owe you a Dreamation piece too, but I'm gonna be a little relaxed on that.
With you, it's okay because I know you're doing other things.
Yeah,
with
well,
the people who go, you know, sup, I want to go to Dreamation, and I'm like, okay, well, where are your like years long backlog full of conventions? And they're like, no, you don't understand. I want to go to Dreamation. Why are you not pushing the button to make this thing happen?
So you're doing your job.
And I've told them that, and they get really pissed. I'm going to keep dining out on these fucking contributors forever because they keep doing this shit to me.
Well, speaking of blabs, one of the things that we're always looking for on the Geek Initiative Presents LARP Chat Live are topics, mm-hmm. suggestions for topics, guests, anything that you want to hear us talk about or you want to participate in talking about with us. So definitely keep your suggestions coming. Mm-hmm. You can always find the Geek Initiative on Facebook and message us there. Let us know what you would like to hear and you would like to see. For the next Blab Chat. LARP Chat. I see we've lost Tara.
We have lost Tara. It's okay because we're still hosts, so we can just essentially, you know, establish a regency government until either she gets back or someone succeeds her.
Yeah, I'm down with that.
I'm for Agnatic Gavelkind just because it's the one thing I never know what it is, but seemingly always pops up in Crusader Kings.
I'm a big fan of Regent. I can marry Sam off to someone to consolidate power in my dynasty.
Oh, yeah, it'll go well.
I need an alliance with Poland, Sam. You got to step up to the plate, dude. Come on. Yeah, well,
alliance
you know,
or
I
invade.
Mean,
one of the two.
Yes, Lee, you can have a vassal state.
You just, you know, send me to some country and, you know, and I'm like, hi, and immediately, capitulation.
Exactly. I have a painting of a
president.
You're fine. Yeah, whatever. It's all
so
cool.
You want to go to France, basically.
And I don't think I could do it in France because they have enough hostile nerds that a hostile, confused, gender-fluid nerd would actually, like, fit right in there.
Exactly. You'll infiltrate. Sleeper agent. You can be a sleeper agent for us.
I buy out the bookstores in Paris.
Yes.
Come on, Sam. Sleeper agent.
Says you bought 5 copies of the Codex Serafinianus. I need them all. I'm sorry. I'm just derailing.
So
is there anything else that we want to talk about? I think Tara had this originally wrapping up around 8:30. Not sure if there's anything else we need to cover.
Something like, I mean, you know, the big thing was we had the special guest and
yes, who's no longer here.
Who's no longer here, so we're just kind of playing mock up and now, you know, Tara's gone. Is kind of the host for tonight.
Yeah, Tara's gone, so now we're negotiating imperial dynasties and war and things like that.
Yeah, yeah.
Like we do.
That's what you do.
So actually, there was one thing. There's a guy I play with. For those who don't know, which is pretty much everybody here, I also help moderate a virtual tabletop sort of social networking site called Inferno. And I'll put the link in the chat because, you know, we definitely need new members. So, you know, and you're all cool people.
Hey, she's back!
I'm back! I am
absolutely nothing, and it was totally fine.
I fangirled so much. It just broke. No, my internet went out, but I'm broadcasting over my phone's Wi-Fi now.
We handled everything. It was fine, and there's nothing you need to review for the time that you were gone.
And
no revolution.
Nothing at all.
Like that.
Okay.
Like that.
And the the name of my Wi-Fi network is Thor Robust Wi-Fi. So Thor saved the day once again.
Yes.
I fangirled so much about Thor. I needed Thor to get back on the internet.
Well, that's the way that works, you know. But yeah, there's actually just on the backing, there's a guy who sort of runs highly emotional games using narrative systems. The big one for a while was Monster Hearts, though now we've kind of sort of splintered into, I think Masks is currently the one that's big and sort of making a resurgence, which is a very story-based, very rules simple superhero game. But what he does is basically kind of try to push for certain emotional situations. And I've actually been like a couple of times on the verge of tears in his games. His name is John. He's actually.
I want to play tabletop games that make me cry because I never have. I've only played LARP that make me cry.
He was actually. I think he had to miss out on Dreamation this year, which bummed me out because for a while I was planning on going to Dreamation until stuff happened with my computer. And so he's there sometimes. He wasn't there this year, but a guy named John Sarigar runs games. And so, yeah, he's like made me cry at least two or three times. And he tries to push for sort of a little more of a downbeat setting just because it'll sort of funnel everything to an emotionally charged thing, the more circumstances dire. And yeah, so.
I need to play more things that make me cry. I mean, like, okay, Sam, I haven't played any role-playing games with you, but Amy, one time, I was at Mystic Realms, and you were playing one of the, what's it called, the cute little creatures with the whiskers?
Weedles. There are little mice people.
You were playing a Weedle.
Yes,
and you were, like, the most adorable Weedle. And you made me feel like I was at home in this village, and I'm playing like the drunk Celt who's just spending all her money on whiskey, and I'm just out for like whiskey, and I get here and I'm like, I might actually spend my money on something other than whiskey because these people are so nice. You were like the only person that convinced me to spend my money on anything other than whiskey. It was great. So I knew I was not going to play the character consistently. I might actually go back at her soon. But I was like, whatever, I'll just blow on booze, you know? Why not? And Amy, your character made me want to like give money to the Weedles in their little town. And Matt, you have made me cry many a time.
Oh, this is
what
I hear.
That's what I
do. Okay, so Matt and I have been writing together for, what, like 7 or 8 years now? A long time.
Oh, one of the top three most intimate things you can do with a person. Go on.
He has made me cry so many times. I'm trying to think of, like, the top time that I was, like, an emotional wreck after reading. It had to be when Mari was in Tirnanog and Jack came to visit her, and I was at work, not my current job, I don't RP while I'm at work, but at a past job, it was in publishing. It was a slow time of year, and I was RPing on Instant Messenger with Matt, and we played out the scene, and I'm like at my desk, and my friend who was sitting like, we had these like cubicle walls, and my friend who's sitting like diagonal to me, just, she's okay. And I'm like, why? Why?
Fortunately, she's a geek,
and she actually ran a Star Trek sim. So like, you know, she was used to the emotions that can come out of text-based role-playing. But I'm like, you don't understand. My character's like sort of dead and stuck in dream world, and like, oh my gosh, she's just crying so hard right now. It was really bad. Then I'm like over here crying, and I'm like sitting at my desk crying, and I was a mess. I didn't get fired though, because it was a slow time and I was doing extra work anyway.
Also, what kind of Dickensian hellhole do you work for that they're like crying at your desk?
Oh my god.
How dare you? Place of business.
Well, it was a very corporate place. Not like where I work now. It was very corporate. Well, yeah, and
you work for like what, new media or something?
Well, now I work at SEM Rush, and it's all about digital marketing, and they're super awesome. And I'm actually publishing a post next Tuesday, I think, on personal branding and how supportive they are about, you know, me being like a nerd and like being openly nerdy. Like, I get to blog about Thor and stuff, and they like retweet it. It's really cool. It's like the best part of my job. And yeah, but back then I worked at an academic publisher, and they were like a little bit more by the book, you know. It was more of like a red pen editor type job, not a cool blog editor kind of job. So but there I was, an emotional wreck because of Matt. Damn you.
We once wrote a storyline for Mr. Elms for our Evermore game. It was Yule, so it was Christmas time. And I was playing my little mouse person, but we were having an issue in our village, and we needed all of our player characters to enter a dream world. And it was only an hour, and all they had to do was survive it. But we, as the NPC crew, basically confronted them with their worst nightmares. And we were like a scene into it. We weren't even fully into the scene. The first characters came onto the scene. One was dragging the other, ready to crucify him. And people were already crying. It was awesome. It was terrible. But we came back, and then after that scene wrapped up and we were done for the night, we came back to the inn for the Yule celebration, and we walk in and it's like silent and people are crying and we ruined Christmas.
Oh my god.
We ruined Christmas. It was really awesome as an NPC, but terrible. Terrible as an NPC. But yeah.
One
made them cry pretty badly. Well,
one of Corey's characters, she was NPCing at a 7K event, and she came in and it was a similar thing. It was like a dream world scenario, and she comes in and blames my character. She's like, "This is all your fault. You did this. Your people." And CR is like, "Wait, my people? Do you mean the Firbolg? Do you mean like the fairies? Like, which people do you mean? Like, let's be specific here." And like, there were no specifics. Like, I was trying to like get more info from the NPC, you know. And she was like, "You did this," and my character just freaked out. And Kane had to take her hand and like pull her out of this area. It was like, it was the worst. She was a wreck. And then everyone was like, "Kane, what did you do to CR to make her cry?" And he's like, "I'm protecting her." CR was just like, she was just a total mess. Yeah. And Corey loves to make characters cry, so I'd love to role play with her. I realize not everyone here knows Corey, but I love role playing with her because she likes to make people cry, and I like making my characters suffer emotionally. Which, something's wrong with me. I don't know why I like that.
You need non-role-playing therapy.
All of my characters, it's true. Like, all of my characters have an unrequited love scenario. That's like the thing that I end up playing over and over. Not all of them, most of them. But it's just like, I don't know why.
Well, for the record, I don't like making characters cry. If it comes about as part of the natural, you know,
natural role playing, exactly.
But I don't set out to make anybody cry or ruin Christmas or anything like that. It just kind of happens.
I only ruined Christmas by accident.
I mean, we knew it would be intense, but we didn't think that we'd get them one scene in. I mean, we figured it would take a little while, but nope, right away we ruined them. That was good.
That's pretty awesome. I mean, I was clearly on the NPC side for many years to think that was awesome, but now that I PC all the time, I guess because it's like I haven't experienced a lot of loss and grief and stuff like that in real life, which is awesome. But I think that's why I like go for that in game, but also the aforementioned Irish-American cultural aesthetic, I suppose. It's just like inherent, like there has to be a little bit of bitter with the sweet, or it's not like a complete story.
No, you're not wrong. I mean, that's an actual Irish-American aesthetic thing going.
Yeah, it shows up in like everything I write. Sorry, legit, not sorry.
Yeah, legit thing.
It bugs some people too. It's like my thing. It bugs people, but whatever. If you don't like it, don't read it.
The other liar stories, though, that's the thing. I don't really know.
Okay. Well, I think we're done.
No, I'm just going to start crying.
I think so, yeah. I think we've only
on our depressing
Irish
and
we're trying to get audio artifacts.
Yeah, I think that's a good place to stop. Also, I'm hearing all crazy robot noises again. I can't do a song when there's crazy robot noises in my
See,
ear.
It's the AI. Oh. This is what Matt did. He brought it here.
Right? If I can get not crazy robot noises.
Matt, do you mind if I just pop you out for a moment?
Yeah.
All right. Okay,
crazy robot noises.
See, it was Matt.
No crazy robot.
Told you.
It was Matt.
It's he's a combination of like bandwidth stream and feedback. There's because he wasn't using we're all using headphones.
So oh, that's why.
The headphones from, and you know.
All right, so I guess now I'm obligated. Should I might stop recording before.
No, we can't give them back.
All right, so I'm gonna wrap it up and stop recording. But then I will sing to those of you who are still live listeners, and to those of you who aren't, for a mere pledge of $100 to the initiative, I will call you and sing to you. Actually, I totally will. I'm.
Hell yeah! I mean, that keeps us.
I will call you. I will sing you an Irish lullaby. Like,
most of the year.
But before we wrap up, once again, any suggestions for topics that you would like to hear us, quite honestly, babble about? Message us at the Geek Initiative, and if you want to be a participant in one of these exciting chats, definitely hit us up. And next Tuesday, same time, not same place, but close.
For the Geek Initiative,
same-ish place. I'll find you on Facebook. Yes. So again, thank you for joining us for LARP Chat Live. Yep. This is Tara wrapping up for the Geek Initiative. You can find us at geekinitiative.com. Thank you.